One of the things I know as a woman...
Sorry. Hold it there. I also forgot. The critical ingredient to all of this is mercy. Yeah, I gotta say that. Mercy. Then I mean, I've been saying that for years and I forgot. It's like my like my number one go-to. Number one ingredient for a successful relationship is mercy. You have to know how to love one another mercifully. You have to know how to love yourself mercifully, and you have to know how to show that mercy, because we're broken. We're going to hurt one another. So we have to learn mercy.
Do you have any key relationship advice for Catholic couples? I remember we had a question way back when we started our podcast about what if you designed a Catholic dating site? What would it be like? I think along those lines, you know, just Catholic couples, what are things? And I think too, like, so many people talk to you about their struggles in their relationships. So you've gained a lot of wisdom, not just from your own experience, but other people's.
Gosh, where could you begin? First I would say, immerse yourself, please. I beg of you. I know I sound like a broken record here, but that's kind of my job as a teacher of the theology of the body, to encourage people really to immerse themselves in this vision. I don't know a better way to prepare yourself for what life will dish out and what human relationships will dish out, what you'll encounter, the joys and the trials. I don't know a better preparation for that than really immersing yourself in John Paul II's vision of what it means to be human. Mm-hmm. And that vision is called the theology of the body.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a great starting point. I would even encourage people who are already dating to make that part of your dating life, is studying it together.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe take the book Good News About Sex and Marriage, which is such an easy format with the Q&A. I actually, one thing I have recommended over the years, when particularly women have come to me at my talks, they'll come up and say, you know, do you have any advice for me? And I say, well, if a guy asks you, I'll give him a copy of this book. Not that I wouldn't say the same thing to guys, but maybe it's more women who are asking me for this kind of advice. I tell the story. The reason I give that advice is because one time a woman came up to me and said, Christopher, you've made my dating life so easy. And I said, well, how?
Uh-huh.
And she said, well, whenever a guy asks me out, I just give him a copy of your Q&A book.
Uh-huh.
And I say, read this. And if you want to live that, maybe I'll go out with you. And I loved her sassy attitude. You know, it wasn't like, I'll definitely go out with you. It was like, maybe. It was
maybe.
Like, she's establishing the baseline.
Yeah.
Like, this is what we got to agree on if we want to have a relationship. And I thought that was superb.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we should have those kind of standards for ourselves. You should want to have a baseline that this is how we want to establish a relationship. This is what we're aiming for. It's hard enough. You and I know this.
Yeah.
We were aiming for that. We're still aiming for that.
Yeah.
And you have to deal with your broken humanity.
Yeah.
It's there. It doesn't go away. So we need tools to love ourselves and love others in our broken humanity. And I think what the culture kind of fosters, what it creates, and what I want to stand against, and this is one of my main pieces of advice that I give to people who want to date, to people who are dating. The culture creates this environment where we are afraid to be naked with one another. And I don't mean physically naked. I mean spiritually naked.
Yeah.
There's a lot of physical nakedness going on and very little spiritual nakedness going on. And that's putting the cart before the horse. We're afraid to open our hearts. We're afraid to be vulnerable. We're afraid to share who we really are. And that is very concerning, because dating becomes, and attracting a date, for example, or attracting a potential mate, spouse, however you want to put that, in our culture is almost a process of putting on more and more masks so that you can be found, quote, attractive. And really, if you want to know if you're in a good relationship, and I look back at our history here, and I know the masks that I wore and how that confused our relationship, I was wearing all kinds of masks growing up because I was afraid that I was unlovable with my masks off. I did what I knew how to do at the time in our relationship.
Just pause there for a minute, because that is in itself a beautiful gift. Just want to say that to
you. What do you want to say?
That you did do what you knew how to do. And I just want to encourage our listeners also that you don't have to be perfect and then start dating.
Yeah, amen to that.
And don't reflect back on your relationships and just see a list of mistakes, because as we were talking about earlier, you are a gift.
Yeah,
and
amen.
Your gift has been given to some extent in this relationship, and that is good. So I just want to affirm that. I have some other thoughts too, but you can.
Yeah, the point here is that we have to learn, if you're going to be establishing a relationship, you have to learn how to take those masks off. Mm-hmm. And you don't get totally spiritually naked all at once.
No.
But you start revealing yourself. You start sharing your real self. You start making yourself vulnerable. And if that gift is received, then it will most likely be reciprocated. And then you're on this journey together of going deeper and deeper mm-hmm. into true, into me see, right? Mm-hmm. Into me see, intimacy. That's what is required to establish a relationship that lasts, is intimacy, mm-hmm. true seeing of the other. But you can't establish that intimacy if you're not revealing yourself. And here's a metaphor I like to use. I'm sure I've used this before on the podcast, but here we go again. A man's heart is like a deep cave, and there's so many caverns in there. And the job of the woman in his life is to go spelunking, to go exploring in that deep cave. But she can't go poking around in that cave if he doesn't open it to her. Mm-hmm. We have to learn how to open those caverns of our hearts as men. I like to say a woman's heart is like a deep ocean. Mm-hmm. And the mission of that man in her life is to go deep sea diving. Mm-hmm. But he can't go poking around in her ocean if she doesn't reveal that. That would be a violation. Mm-hmm. So there's this dance of revelation, of revealing our hearts, of opening our hearts, of making ourselves vulnerable. And you and I have both experienced this, that when we do that to the degree that we're able at the stage of the relationship we're in, this is what makes it so exciting, that there's always a new level to go. Mm-hmm. You never exhaust the infinite value and dignity of the person. You never exhaust it.
Right.
It is in some way infinite. And if you don't know that, if you feel like you've exhausted and all, this person's just boring, well, there's a block to intimacy somewhere. Something has shut down in the relationship, because there's always more to discover. And what I was going to say is, what you and I have experienced is that you'll pull treasures out of these caverns in my heart, so to speak, that I didn't even know were in there.
Yeah.
And I'll discover treasures in your deep ocean that you didn't even know were in there. And it really is a great image. Like, I see you like coming out of the cavern. Look at it. Look what I discovered here. And oh my gosh. Wow. You see stuff in me. You pull out the best of me, and vice versa. We've had that experience. So the bottom line in real human relating is intimacy. And that takes vulnerability. And vulnerability is scary, because we've been hurt, we've been burned, we've not been seen, we've not been honored, we've been wounded, we've been rejected. And so understandably, we are afraid to be vulnerable. And so we wear those masks, and we put up those barriers, and we build walls to protect ourselves. But authentic love is worth the risk of taking those masks off, of tearing those walls down, of making yourself vulnerable. And it's the only way to know if you have a relationship that's built on a solid foundation. Really.
That's really good.
So I would summarize by saying, a foundation of agreed vision for what you think your relationship should be, which should be informed by the true, the good, and the beautiful, which John Paul holds out in a way that just resonates with human hearts. I'd start there. And then the commitment to journey in real intimacy. Those are the things I think make for a successful relationship.
One of the things I know as a woman...
Oh, sorry. Hold it there. I also forgot the critical ingredient to all of this is mercy. Yeah, I got to say that. mercy, 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 mercy. Then I mean, I've been saying that for years and I forgot. It's like my, like my number one go-to. Number one ingredient for a successful relationship is mercy. You have to know how to love one another mercifully. You have to know how to love yourself mercifully, and you have to know how to show that mercy, because we're broken. We're going to hurt one another. So we have to learn mercy.
Amen.
Sorry, I had to say it.
That I get it.
Yeah.
As a woman, I know that I have had the experience prior to meeting you, but also relating to you, where I don't know everything about you up front. And so there's something just that begins that attraction, something. It could be about your appearance. It could be about the way that you behave in a certain circumstance. It could be just an interaction that we've had that gets my attention. But I think there is a tendency, I mean, in an extreme way, this is like a crush, where you just kind of manufacture a whole image of who this person is that you're kind of super attracted to, and you don't really know the real person maybe at all.
Yep.
I mean, could be like, this is somebody that's a famous person that you have a crush on,
right?
That you just only know the images. You don't know the real person at all. I think that tendency is not like fundamentally wrong, in the sense that we do have to kind of fill in the blanks quickly in our relating with people in order to just, you know, get along with people. But there's a need for us to be honest that I don't really know all these things that I imagine about this person.
Yes.
And just to, as you said, mercifully, but just honestly be aware of that the dating relationship is not just, I've imagined you are this and I need all that, so be that for me now. Like, that's not what the healthy relationship is. The healthy relationship begins with that attraction, or, you know, that desire to be together, but it has to remain open to, I want to know the real person and not the one just that I imagined you to be. And that sometimes in the process of the relationship, that can be upsetting, to discover a way that you're not who I imagined you to be, or to find that I'm not who you imagined me to be.
So
I think that in a mature relationship, that's definitely going to be part of it, and kind of going in just knowing that that's part of relationships is a great preparation. And I think, like what you said about revealing your real self, mercy, all of that is just essential. I think also I want to just speak to younger people who maybe aren't at this level.
Yes.
Where if you tell, you know, say a 15-year-old that's dating, your goal is to be more and more, you know, vulnerable.
Sure.
It could be not the best advice at that age.
Yeah, yeah. I had in mind, you know, people who are looking to get married. I'm thinking
soon.
People in their 20s.
Yes,
or,
older people. Yeah. So I just wanted to throw in you know, though at that stage, the younger years of dating, it's important to almost kind of check yourself on your tendency to reveal yourself. To think about, would I tell my best friend or my parent or, you know, someone else in my life this same information about me, that you're not over revealing to this person you're dating? Because what can happen there is that you're kind of entrusting too much of yourself to a person who isn't really ready to treasure what you're entrusting. So there, that you were talking about stage of relationship, and I think there's just a stage of maturity as well in there.
That's a very important point.
And also related to that stage of maturity, I just want to throw in Theology of the Body for Beginners. Just because Good News About Sex and Marriage may get into some topics for those younger dating people that wouldn't be really appropriate for them to read together and discuss.
Good point.
That was also maybe advice toward older people. So I just had these younger people in my mind and wanted to throw in just a few more comments for them, because they may be also our listeners.
I love it. I love it. And I'll add this one thought too. The getting the vision, the shared vision together, here's one example of how important that is. Part of reality. It's not just this Catholic vision. It's the way the world is. It's reality that no human relationship can really satisfy the yearning of the human heart. We are made for something more. We're made for the infinite. Mm-hmm. And marriage, as beautiful and wonderful as it is only a sign of something else. It's a sign of the marriage that lasts forever, Christ and the church. That's what we're made for. That's what you yearn, that's what we're really yearning for. When we don't understand that, and we seek to find in another human being something that will satisfy that ache, we're setting ourselves up for disaster. And you and I know that firsthand. We understood that as a concept when we got married, mm-hmm. but in many ways we're still looking to one another to fill something that only God can fill. This is why I think faith is so essential to real human relating, because faith is the openness to that eternal gift, and it relieves the pressure of expecting the other or even demanding the other, meet all my needs, fulfill yeah. all my needs. If you go into a relationship realizing this fundamental truth that St. Augustine said oh so well, you have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless till they rest in thee. If you really and truly live from that place, it's like a relief valve on the pressure we can put on human relationships to be my be-all and end-all, which they can't be. Human right. relationships can't be that. They're meant to be little tastes, little signs, oh. and marriage is meant to yes. be a sacrament of that reality. And I love that about our love for one another. It's mm-hmm. really a sacrament. But to demand out of human relationships what only God can provide is a recipe for disaster. Mm.